Your brain is pretty important. In order to protect it, the body has a system for keeping bad stuff out and letting good stuff in. This is called the blood-brain barrier. This protective barrier acts like the defensive line on the football field, keeping the quarterback brain safe from neurotoxins. The idea of a barrier between your blood and your central nervous system, your brain and your spinal cord, didn't really get started until the late 1800s when a German scientist, Paul Ehrlich, was doing some staining. Ehrlich noticed that the central nervous system came out its natural color while everything else was stained blue. Other experiments show that when those same dyes were injected under the subarachnoid space, one of the layers between the brain and the skull, the brain would turn blue, but not the rest of the body. Ehrlich thought it might be a slightly different structure of blood vessels in the brain compared to the rest of the body, not a new piece of anatomy entirely. But by 1900, Ehrlich's experiments had picked up some interest. One of Ehrlich's students, Edwin Goldman, noticed a buildup of dye around the choroid plexus of the brain. That buildup pointed to a possible entry site. Like how cars will back up behind a stoplight, the dye was backing up right there. The choroid plexus is responsible for making cerebrospinal fluid, or CSF, the fluid that keeps the brain from banging around inside the skull too much. Scientists wondered if this could be the entry site for things like oxygen and glucose, materials that the brain still needs from the blood in circulation. But that job was already taken by the cerebral vasculature, the blood vessels throughout the rest of the brain, and why would you have two different structures to do the same thing? So by the early 1900s, we knew about two barriers, the blood CSF barrier at the choroid plexus, and the blood brain barrier around the rest of the brain. But they still didn't really know what the barrier was made of. Luckily, around that time, microscope technology got a huge upgrade with the invention of the electron microscope. For reference, the microscopes you have in your lab probably magnify up to about 40 times, but modern electron microscopes can magnify in the range of 10,000s. It turned out to be what we now call tight junctions, tightly packed together cells which left almost no space for materials to pass through. Water, glucose, and some important amino acids could pass through, but it kept those bad neurotoxins out. The barrier wasn't a picket fence, it was more like a solid steel wall. Important to note, not all parts of the brain have this barrier. For example, the pineal gland secretes the sleepy time hormone melatonin directly into the blood without having to cross a barrier. Which is good, because it's time to put this topic to rest. Thanks for watching. I hope you enjoyed the new style. I've been really busy writing scripts for SciShow lately, and if you want to watch a few of those, you can check those out right here. And if you think that this video earned your subscription, I would definitely appreciate you clicking on my face right there. Have fun, be good, I'll see you next time.